Well, good morning and happy Sabbath to every one of you. Welcome to Adventurer Sabbath. We're so glad that all of you are here. And before you stands our 2013-2014 Adventurer Club, made up of 17 boys and girls between the ages of 4 and 9. We have one of our adventurers missing today, Carol Casasolo, so we want to pray for her and her family today and tell them that we miss the fact that they're not here with us. But we do have everyone else here, and our voices are strong and our hearts are filled with the love of Jesus. We hope yours are too. And we just want to welcome each one of you. And so with that, adventurers, let's say our adventurer pledge.
Because Jesus loves me, I will always do my best.
Now let's recite the adventurer law.
Ready, begin.
Jesus can help me be obedient, be pure, be true, be kind, be respectful, be receptive, be helpful, be cheerful, be thoughtful.
And now we're going to ask each one of you to join with us in singing songs of worship to the Lord.
Thank you.
Well, good morning again, church. My husband, Bud, and I are here today to just let you know about a few important things happening with and through the church. Why don't you go first?
Well, I'm here to bring to the attention the bulletin that we have a birthday. And the flowers today are in honor of a birthday. If there's a birthday girl here who has dark black hair. Betty. Hi.
Hi, Betty.
We want to wish you a happy birthday. The flowers are in honor of Betty's birthday.
Okay, oops, and as I'm dropping the announcements, one really important thing that I think as a church we need to know about and acknowledge is the fact that Ann Bleck is being awarded the 2014 Excellence in Teaching Award, and that's going to be on May 22nd. You can see on this yellow flyer there the details of when that honoring and celebration will occur, and so plan to be there to support her. Hi, Ann. Wave. Why don't you stand up in the back end so those people who don't know who you are can see who you are. That's Ann Bleck. Ann does a great job of teaching the first through third graders at Linda Vista.
And the one over here?
Yeah.
Okay, just a reminder for next week's events on Monday the 12th. There's a Linda Vista Finance Board meeting. So for those who are part of that, please have that on your calendars.
Yes, and then, you know, every week for probably the next couple of months, you're going to see this Pathfinder flyer inserted in your bulletin with all the opportunities you have to help the Pathfinders raise funds in order to go to Camp Ree in Oshkosh this August. One of the things, and I'll just speak loudly enough so you can hear me, one of the things that's ongoing for another couple of weeks is the M&M containers. If you have M&M containers, be sure to bring them back by May 24th with your quarters inside, or if you feel like you have more than $14 worth of quarters you can give, we will welcome that as well. So by May 24th, we need to have these back. And note too that there's going to be a talent show, and a week from tomorrow, May 18th, Sunday, there will be auditions for that talent show, and then the talent show itself will be on June 1st. So if you have any questions about Pathfinders today or any of the activities going on, you can see either myself or Pastor Dennis today. All right? Yes, and we will switch to this for safekeeping. All right. Well, now we are going to bless you with a handbell piece, and this is a hymn called How Firm a Foundation. Thank you. Okay, and at this time, we would like to invite all the kids in the church up for the children's story. And I'm actually going to ask you to face up this way so that you can see the screen up here. Whoops. Okay. This story is kind of personal to me and my family. And you know, when Mr. Sanders and I first got to know each other, Mr. Sanders had a couple of cats whom he'd had for a while, and this is one of those two cats, and his name was Farrell. Now, Farrell was a big, handsome, fluffy Maine Coon cat. He had a big swishy tail, we used to say. And he was very self-assured. When he walked into a room, he knew he was hot stuff. And he was also very sociable. In fact, most of the time when we had company over to the house, he would sit on the couch right behind somebody's head because he liked being near people. He was very sociable, and he liked to play, and he was a very skillful hunter. He would come with birds and gophers and all kinds of things. And when he walked into a room, heads would turn, probably because he was so self-assured and so handsome. And his attitude was, I could be friends with anybody. But his flaw was that he was a real tease. Then the other cat we had was Tilly. Cute little Tilly. She had a cute round head, and she was fluffy, but mostly in the winter. She was just an American short-haired cat. We called her the barn cat, right? And she was kind of aloof. Does anybody know what the word aloof means? Kind of standoffish. She wasn't so much a people cat. And she was really more of an introvert. She loved to sleep, though. She was great at sleeping. Yeah, great at sleeping. And when she entered a room, you might not even know it because she was probably slinking behind the furniture to get to the food. And her attitude was, friends, who needs them? Very different from Farrell. And her flaw, she hated to be teased. You can kind of see the problem. Well, you know, when Mr. Sanders and I started spending time together, Tilly here didn't like that too much. She was kind of used to having all her humans' love to herself. And Farrell a little bit too, but he was just such a nice, friendly cat that it didn't seem to bother him too much. You know what cats do when they get what we call territorial, when they want to indicate to somebody else, this is mine? What do, Phoebe? They spray. And is it perfumey and smell like flowers? Is it nice when they spray? What do? They back up to something, and they put their tail in the air, and it shakes a little bit, and out comes this spray that, if you can smell, smells really awful. Really awful. But that says, you know what it says to other cats, and I think in the cat's mind to anybody else, that's mine. Well, when I came around, Tilly started to spray. In fact, one day, Mr. Sanders had his Bible out and open, and you know what she did? She sprayed on his Bible. She was making her displeasure with the new girl very known. Well, that didn't dissuade Mr. Sanders and I from getting married. We got married anyway. And Tilly wasn't too happy about that at first. But then, as we lived together and spent time together, and Tilly might find herself in a pickle of a situation like this. Where is Tilly? Can you tell? She's in the bathtub.
Do cats like being in bathtubs? No. Well, she found herself stuck one day in the bathtub, and so who do you think had to help her out? Me. And then every day as I fed her her food, you know, eventually, Tilly and Farrell were once in a while nice to each other, but eventually, Tilly and I became friends. Well, you see what that says? At least that's what she thinks. That's Tilly talking, huh? So Tilly was not the most welcoming of cats, right? Farrell was pretty good. And over many years of spending time together as a family and with these two cats, sadly, one day, we lost Farrell. And that was a really sad occasion for our family. But it was a big win for Tilly. You know why? Tilly didn't have to be teased by Farrell anymore. You know, when I first met Tilly, she didn't even meow. You know what she used to do? She'd meep. 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 That's all you'd ever hear out of her. And then she'd slink behind the furniture and go to the food and then slink back out of the room and go to sleep. Well, now that Farrell was gone and she was kind of used to me, she'd walk into a room and let you know that she was there. Meow, meow. Hi, I'm here, everybody. You see me? I don't have that pesky cat chasing me anymore. So Tilly was awfully happy. Until along came Buster. One day we were at a friend's house. We got out of the car and Zoe said to me, "Mommy, I hear a kitty cat crying." Sure enough, there in the bushes was a little kitten, Buster. "Well, what are we going to do, Mommy?" "I don't know. We should try to find, see if anybody around here owns it." And so we drove around and nobody owned it. And so we thought, well, we can't just leave it here. We'll take it home and try to find it a good home. And Mr. Sanders said to Mrs. Sanders, "Whatever you do, don't give it a name. If you give it a name, you're not giving it away." And by the time the weekend was over, his name was Buster Dudley Hobbs. And he was ours. And who do you think was not happy about that? Because this was Buster. This isn't a very good picture, but this kind of is who Buster is. "Come on, let's go. Let's play. Come on, Tilly." And what does Tilly like to do? Sleep. Yeah, so that's kind of how she felt about Buster. Not too welcoming, huh? Not too welcoming. And who wouldn't want to be friends with a beautiful cat like that? Tilly. So what is the point of all of this? You know, when we are a church, even when we're an adventurer club or something like that, what kind of people do we want to be? Do we want to be like a Farrell who is friendly and who will welcome anybody and come sit right next to you and make you feel welcome? Or do we want to be like a Tilly and start spraying on our territory and saying, "This is ours. You're not welcome here. We don't want to share the love of Jesus with you. We want to keep it all to ourselves." Who do we want to be like? Like Farrell. Yeah. Because we don't want to keep people out. We want to welcome people in. So whether it's our adventurer club or our church or whether we're around our neighbors or at school, we want everybody around us to know that Jesus loves them too. Okay, can we remember to be like Farrell? All right, you can go back to your seats now. Thanks, kids.
All over the world today, there are disasters happening that leave people hurt, homeless, and hungry. Our offering today supports the work that the Adventist Development and Relief Agency does to care for those who are in need.
Dear Father in Heaven, please help each one of us here to be thankful for our daily bread and to be willing to give generously in working with you so that all who are in need are provided for. Thank you for all your many blessings. In Jesus' name, amen.
I stand accused. There's a list a mile long of all my sins, of everything that I've done wrong. I'm so ashamed. There's nowhere left for me to hide. This is the day I must answer for my.
Stretch them out for me and say. Our scripture today is found in 1 John 3:18. I'll be reading the New International Version. Dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with actions and in truth. All who are able, please kneel for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful day you've given us. Keep everyone safe as we finish this week. Help us to learn more about you and do what you want us to do. And help everyone who's sick and wasn't able to be here. And help all the children who are in school to finish the school year well. And just help us to glorify your name today. Amen.
Have you been blessed this morning? Aren't you proud of our kids? Adventurers, you are special. They look so sharp. They are sharp. Sharp as a tack, right? How many of you know what that means? The older generation does. Yes. Well, it is just exciting to be a part of a church family that has so many exciting young people and a team of leaders that take the responsibility and the time, and it takes great dedication and love to prepare every week for Adventure Club. Hours are spent, and I know that because I've seen them at work, and we just are so blessed to have Claudette leading the team, and her team are just awesome. So thank you all for the work that you do to prepare our children and for heaven. You know, I think, yes, thank you. What a blessing it is to our church and to our community, because they do community outreach. You do know that, don't you? They do. And so it's not just coming to church, not just coming here on Wednesday or a Sabbath afternoon. It's also going out into the harvest field and sharing Jesus there. And they do it as they go home, too, and share it with mom and dad, right? Tell mom and dad about what Jesus has been doing in your life and what you're learning about him and his plans for you for the future. And it's my personal belief that as we get closer and closer to the coming of Jesus, some unique things are going to begin to happen. And one of the greatest of these is that children are going to lead us in preparation for the kingdom. And I'll say more about that in a few minutes. But pause on that. Think about that for a moment. How many of you remember your childhood when you trusted everybody? Remember that? Until mom and dad said, don't trust everybody. For good reason, I understand that. But we had to educate our kids not to trust. In our heart, when we were created by God, he gave us the ability to trust one another. Until sin comes along and messes that all up. And skews that trust relationship. But Jesus wants us to get back into that trust relationship. And so, as we get closer and closer to Jesus' coming, our children who have been learning from you, mom and dad, at home, and from all of their Sabbath school teachers and leaders, and from their Adventure Club leaders and their Pathfinders, and all of us in church are going to take the message where we adults can't go. So we have limited time. Jesus is coming soon. So what I want you to focus on this morning is love in action. You've been seeing it already at work this morning. Love in action through the leaders to the children back to all of us, and to moms and dads as we go home and have fun together, learning more and more about Jesus and his love for us. Well, the Bible actually says a lot about the role of children in preparing God's people for the kingdom of God. I want you to focus on this one. In Psalms 8, verses 1 and 2, here's what the psalmist writes. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Notice this next verse. From the lips of children and what? Not only children, but infants. You have ordained praise because of your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. I looked this up in the Application Bible because sometimes I like to just compare what Bible authors say. And notice what the Application Bible says. You have taught the little children to praise you perfectly. I like that. That's a little more modern spin on what it says from the lips of children. So may their example shine and silence your enemies. There you have it. Children, you are at the front of leading us closer and closer to heaven. So children, what we want you to learn here in the Camarillo Seventh-day Adventist Church is that you can trust and praise God always. That you can trust Jesus implicitly. Now that's a big word. What does implicitly mean? Implicitly means you can trust Him in every way. You can trust Him always because He is your Creator God. Sometimes what we find as we get older, we get more cynical, we get more distrustful of people in particular, and sometimes even God. And that is sad, really sad. So I say, let's become as little children so that we learn to seek God with all of our heart, mind, and soul. And we ask God to give us childlike attitudes and characters and remove the barriers to having a closer walk with Jesus. You know, there's a story in the Bible about a young baby by the name of Samuel. But before we get to the baby, we've got to talk about mom and dad, don't we? And so I'd like to revisit for just a few moments this morning the story of Samuel. And what we find in 1 Samuel 1 is that Hannah, with her husband Elkanah, has traveled to the temple to worship God. They did that every year, once a year, they went to the temple. And Elkanah, you watched all these other mothers with their children, and she was just so heartbroken that she did not have a child. She was so sad. It was a sad time in her life. And so on one of her yearly trips with Elkanah to the temple to worship God, she stood there, not too far from the priest called Eli, and began to talk to God. But she did it in an unusual way. Apparently, she didn't have anything in her hands, and she was there talking to God, just focusing, probably looking up in heaven, and just moving her arms. I can see her being very animated and not saying it out loud, but her mouth is moving, and she is just going through some very unusual actions to the point where Eli came over and may have even tapped her on the shoulder and said, excuse me, but you know, if you're under the influence of alcohol, you shouldn't be in the temple. What? Under the influence of alcohol? Me? No. I haven't been drinking. I'm okay. Well, then what's the problem? Well, you see, and then she told her story to Eli, the high priest. Eli, I want a child. And God hasn't blessed me with a child. What did Eli do? He said, oh, forgive me for thinking that you had been drinking something, but I see the problem, and you know what? God's going to bless you. You don't worry from this point on. And guess what? Wasn't too many months that went by, and pretty soon she began to experience the early signs of pregnancy. Now, moms, I've never experienced that. But some of you have. Some of you have experienced more challenges with those early days of pregnancy than others. Morning sickness, you name it, all those other issues that go on with being a mother. And I have to conclude that on Mother's Day, and we thank you for being our moms. This is a dual story today. It's for kids and moms. But you know what? She was so happy. She was thrilled. Now, when Eli told her that she was going to be a mother, she began to praise the Lord. And she said, Lord, if you bless me with a child, I am going to give that child, she knew it was going to be a boy, I'm going to give that little boy to you, Jesus. And so, little Samuel was born. And mom decided when it was time to go to the temple to worship God on that yearly visit, she was going to stay home and take care of Samuel. And she stayed home the second year. And the third year, she went with Eli to the temple with little Samuel. Now, what had mom said when she gave birth to Samuel? Do you know what she said? She said something very special. She named him Samuel because Samuel means asked of God. You find that in 1 Samuel verse 17. Asked of God. So, here she is, bringing Samuel back for the first visit to God's house. At age what? How old was he, boys and girls? How old do you have to be to join Adventure Club? You have to be 4. And you come for an hour or an hour and a half. Samuel was 3. And mom is bringing him to the temple to give him in service and in gratitude for God's gift of giving her a baby. Pause there for a moment, moms. How many of you would be willing to do that with any of your children? Think about that. I mean, this story is incredible. Talk about the ultimate test of faith and trust in God. She knew she had 3 years to instill everything that she could about God in that little mind of Samuel. And I think she did an exceptional job. Would you agree? When you study the story of Samuel, an amazing man, amazing prophet, who was coming into not the most wonderful environment in the temple of God, sad to say. Eli's sons were not good influences on anybody. So here is Samuel, 3 years old, and his mom gives him to Eli so that Samuel could begin his responsibilities as a servant of God at what age? 3 years old. Do we have any 3-year-olds here today? Oh, your little brother's 3? Awesome! Mom, wouldn't that be a test? Ooh, ay, ay, ay. And Hannah's 3? Wow. 3 years old. how heartbreaking that is. I can't imagine. Let me just give you an example. When our sons finished academy, you go on to where? Typically, you go on to college. Now, it was the first time that Michelle and I were experiencing separation from any of our kids. Now, it was a little easier with my oldest son because that summer, I was going to summer camp to be the assistant director, and we were leaving about the same time. She was taking him to Southern, and I was going off to camp. So it was a little easier on that one. Now, when our second son was getting ready, we're now at a new location, new job at Shenandoah, and Rochelle and I knew what was coming. The oldest son was already out of the nest, but now the baby at 18 years of age is leaving the fold. And we had talked about this, Rochelle and I had, and we said, you know, we've got to be strong. Got to be strong, right? You know what I'm talking about, parents? Those of you that have been through this know what I'm talking about. Okay, we've got to be strong. So it was a two-story house, and his bedroom was upstairs. We were downstairs, and we heard him coming down the stairs, and we heard him going, and then he just started bawling. Well, how do you not join in? So we all start bawling. You know, I'm thinking about, we were packing the car the next day, and I'm driving him to Southern Adventist University to start his new career as a student there. Oh, that was all. That was 18 years of age. Now, Samuel had just been weaned. He and Mom had a tight relationship. And she's leaving him there in the temple. So, Hannah took Samuel to Eli. In 1 Samuel 1, we'll pick up the story there with verse 26. She says to Eli, "Don't you remember me?" And then he thought, "Oh, yeah. You were the lady that I thought had some issues going on, but wow, this is the baby? Yes, and remember, I promised to give him to God. And so I'm here, we're here to give him to you." Here's what she said. "As surely as you live, my Lord, I am the woman who stood there beside you praying to the Lord. I prayed for the child, or this child, and the Lord granted me what I asked of him. So now I give him to the Lord. For his whole life he will be given over to the Lord." And he worshiped the Lord there. Now that's tough love in action, isn't it? For you as a mother to give your child to that degree to the Lord. Now, I hope and I believe that all of you mothers and dads are giving your children to the Lord. Even before they were born, you were giving them to the Lord. And you're continuing to do that and to lead them into a relationship with the Lord that is powerful and strong. And you're teaching them about the importance of prayer. Now, if you want some good reading, go home this afternoon and read 1 Samuel chapter 2, where her prayer is listed for her son Samuel in his life. It was a prayer of thanksgiving. It was a prayer of gratitude. It was a prayer of, "Lord, you were awesome. You answered my prayers. You did a miracle in my life so that I can have and we can have this gift, this little boy Samuel, and I'm giving him to you." And so, how did Mom remember Samuel? Did she just walk away and forget Samuel? No. The story goes on. Mom went back home, and what did she start to do? Sew the coat for the next year. And so each year she made him a coat. Each year it had to get bigger. How would how do you do that, Mom? He's not there for you to measure him and get the exact height and measurements, all of that. But God helped her, I believe, and the miracle was that every year she brought him a new coat. Probably for as long as she was able to sew. How special was that? Now, Samuel was a pretty special guy. The Lord blessed him. Eli, from that first day on, was teaching him simple tasks around the tabernacle of how to take care of it and keep it clean and neat, and how he was explaining to him all the furniture, you know, the table of showbread and altar of incense and the candlesticks, and out in the courtyard was the laver and then the altar of burnt offering. And so every day he was learning, he, Samuel, was learning a new responsibility of how to take care of God's house. Just as all of you are learning how to take care of God's house here, right? You make sure nothing gets broken. You make sure everything is in its proper place. You pick up the trash when you're out and around the church when you see it. You take care of Jesus' house, just like Samuel did in the temple. The Bible says that as Samuel grew into adulthood, he was blessed by God, and everything the Lord had told him about Eli and his family came true. Now, let me explain that. As Samuel grew, got a little older, and one night, something unusual happened. This wasn't the norm. In the middle of the night, he hears this voice, "Samuel! Samuel!" Samuel thinks it's Eli, so he jumps up and he runs to Eli and says, "Yes, Master. Yes, Eli, I'm here. Eli, or Samuel, I didn't call you. Go back and go to sleep." So Samuel goes back a second time. "Samuel, Samuel," the voice calls. Again, he runs to Eli. "Yes, you called. How can I help you?" "I didn't call you." Happens three times. Finally, Eli figures out something's up. So he says to Samuel, "This time, Samuel, if the voice calls you again, you answer, 'Here I am, Lord, how can I help you?'" I'm paraphrasing Samuel's words. And sure enough, the voice came, "Samuel, Samuel." And so what does Samuel do? He said, "Yes, Lord, I'm here, how can I help you?" And then the Lord told him a very sad story. He says, "Samuel, I need you to give a message to Eli." Now, Eli was getting way up in age. And he said to, "Lord, do I have to give him this message? Lord, I really don't want to give Eli the message you just gave me." "Yes, Samuel, you need to give it to Eli." So the next morning, Samuel's a little slower in getting up. But finally, Eli approaches him and he says, "Samuel, I need to know everything the Lord told you last night. Everything. Don't hold anything back. I need to know everything." And in a nutshell, Samuel had to tell Eli that the Lord had removed the ministry from him and that his two sons, who were not following the Lord, were going to die. And that the Ark of the Covenant would be taken from the temple by their arch enemies, the Philistines. Oh no. Would you like to have given a person you loved? Eli loved Samuel. Eli just really loved Samuel. But he knew that God was using Samuel, and he trusted Samuel, and he respected God's message, even though it was a hard message to learn. So Samuel His life was a life of service and duty. So moms and dads, I want to encourage you along life's journey today that I want you to be prepared to give your three-year-old son, your two-year-old son, your one-year-old son, and daughters, by the way, not just sons, but daughters too, give your children God's gift of love. Teach your children to love God. Teach your children to show you what God can do when we give Him our all in service for Him. Jesus reminds us in Matthew 18, moms and dads, we need to remember this, about a great principle of heaven. Here's what Jesus said to His disciples when they said, who is going to be, notice the who is going to be the greatest in heaven? Here was Jesus' answer, beginning with verse 2, Matthew 18. He called a little child and had him stand among them. And he said, John, come up and join me. Come on up. Come on up. Called a little child. He said, I tell you the truth. Unless you change and become like little children, you will never, never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoever welcomes a little child like this in my name welcomes me. That's a great promise, isn't it? Thank you, John. Children, adventurers, please lead us home to heaven, will you? And in John 1, or 1 John 3, 18, our scripture for the day says, dear children, let us not love with what? Words, read it with me, or tongue, but with actions and in truth. May that be our motto from this day forward. Let's all be disciples of Jesus, just as a three-year-old Samuel was, and a faithful mother who gave her child to Jesus at a very tender age.
Thank you, Pastor Dennis. That was very fitting for what we were trying to say to all of you today. Along the lines of what Pastor Dennis is saying, you know, I heard one time at a homeschool convention, a keynote speaker talk about how our children are Generation Joshua. If you think of us adults as Generation Moses, Moses never did make it to the Promised Land. It was Joshua who escorted the people in. And I think that's who we are training up in our adventurers, our pathfinders, in our schools, and most importantly, in our homes. With that, I just want to make a few concluding comments to end our adventurer year. We're going to take the summer off now and start up again in September. But I first of all want to thank our pastors for the support that they give us all year long. I want to thank specifically Jenny Bayo and Heidi Pennock for being willing to teach the youngest two groups of our adventurers. If I didn't have them to do that, there's no possible way this club would exist, because I can only be in so many places at one time, and they're always so faithful and willing and ready to help, and I appreciate that. I also want to thank God for placing us in a church that is always so generous. I don't know that you can appreciate this. We've been other places where the size of the body of Christ in a church would seem that numbers wouldn't be a problem and resources wouldn't be a problem, but that isn't always the truth. And for as small a congregation as we have here, you need to understand your effectiveness. And every time that we have asked for you to help with the resources to do the ministry that we'd hope to do, you've never let us down. And so for that, we are very grateful to God and to each one of you. And just to highlight a few things that we got to experience this year, we did get to learn about our early Adventist pioneers, thanks to Dave Pennock here, who has a great wealth of knowledge about our church history, and we had a great time doing that. We got to go to Griffith Observatory and learn some about astronomy, and we had firefighters come and talk to us about safety. And when we put out the call to you to help us to reach out to Casa Pacifica, and I don't want you to forget about Casa Pacifica because they're still there and they still have need, but when we asked you to give diapers and things for the little ones that are having to live there because of their families' sad and distressed circumstances, you really came through. And when we went there, I have to say that while we only visited with two small children, there were also two workers. And we need not forget about them, because these are the people who, around the clock, are serving these kids who are in desperate need of the love of Jesus. So thank you for that. And then toward the end of the year, I felt a real burden for us as adventurers to reach out to another set. I don't know if it's because my mother-in-law lives with us and we're kind of aware of that the elderly are very often forgotten about, but I felt a burden to get us over to Emeritus and visit with the people who live there. And I don't know about the adventurers and how they all felt about it and how the parents who were there felt about it, but in my mind, it was one of the most successful things we did all year long, because you could see tangibly on their faces and in the comments that they made how much it meant to them that these children were there to visit them and to give them something to remember them by. In fact, our daughter Phoebe came home and Nana was asking her, so how did it go? And I heard Phoebe from the other room say, Nana, it was wonderful. So for an 8-year-old to get that, it's kind of precious, isn't it? So with that, I just want to make a shameless plug for those of you who have kids who are or will be ages 4 to 9 come September. We want to invite you. We want to welcome you. We want to be ferals. And draw you into our adventure club, as we don't want it to be exclusive. We want that all should know the love of Jesus. We meet the first Wednesday of every month starting in September, and then have one other event per month. Talk with any of the adventurers if you want to find out more, to see the kinds of things that we do, but we would love to have your kids join us. We're going to leave you, not just yet, not totally the end of service, but as far as the adventurers are concerned, we're going to leave you with just some images of our year this past year, and then Pastor Dennis will have a special presentation after that.
Thank you. we're not quite done. I hope that you've seen by the kids up front today and our beautiful slideshow what a great year we've had and how wonderful our kids are. I don't think I need to say any more. Claudette and Pastor have said enough about how important our kids are, and we could not have done this without you, Claudette. You put in so much time and dedication to our kids, and just a few words on behalf of all us parents and all our adventure kids, thank you, and we just have a very little token of our appreciation, so if you wouldn't mind, another round of applause for our fearless leader, Claudette.
Why don't you have all of your team stand so everybody knows who they are? That would be all the parents, basically, yeah. But takes a lot of help to make these programs fly. Well, it is, what's tomorrow?
Mother's Day!
How many of you children appreciate your mothers? How much do you appreciate you? If you appreciate your mother, stand up and walk up here and join us. Will you please? All the young people, come up here and join us. Now, when they all get up here, then I'll give moms and all of our ladies of the church. I think we have enough for every lady in our church. A special gift for everyone. So all of our ladies, please stand. And let's give our ladies a hand, will you? All the ladies, you may not be a mother, but that means you're an aunt, an adopted aunt, or so on. So please stand up, make sure everyone gets a light to take home and shine. We want all of you to have a light as you go home. Special music for you yet, so as soon as we can, there's still some ladies standing in the back, and the mother's room, don't forget the mother's room. After all, where would you find a mother? In the mother's room. Okay. All right.
Thank you, moms. Thank you.
Thank you, Matthew. That was beautiful. Thank you, adventurers. Thank you, church family, for all of your love that you give and share with each other. Let's bow our heads as we pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we come to you this afternoon now, thanking you for the blessings that you have given this church. I thank you for these mothers, for their dedication to their families, their children, and to you. May you bless them with a never-ending love. May you inspire them if you've never inspired them before. May their love of and for you grow just bigger than it's ever been before. And may their love of you be seen and heard in their children. May we leave here today with a new desire and a new inspiration to be like you and show our love in action always. In Jesus' name, amen.
Take me to the water to be baptized. Bury me with Jesus, the crucified. Plunge me in the fountain and may I take me to the water.
Take me to